Yeah. Just listening to the birds, which is kind of cool. Yeah, it is. And why not get some leaves in here? Wow, Friday, what a day. I was in an office and someone had the news on, and I haven't heard any news since August of 2015, really. And so I don't know what's going on. And just hearing the stuff, it was on a radio, and just hearing the newscast, I was just like, I had to plug my ears. I actually plugged my ears. It is so horrible. I say, how can anybody with even a tiny bit of integrity pay any attention to this nonsense? This world is nothing but a silly toy that we have desired light to present to us to try and cast doubt on what we are. It's a silly, childish, whimsical toy is all it is. It has no value at all to us. No value in reality. It's all made fake value. Doubt is fake value. There's no value to doubt. None. No value to uncertainty. Absolutely none. And so what, we're supposed to value this world? And yet we still see something that reminds us of, oh, faint tinges, right? Sure, there's nothing wrong with that. But as a whole, are we supposed to say, oh yeah, this is our home, this has value? No, of course not. It's just, I think everybody's just getting freaked out. But the world is not a, never, it's a silly toy. If we don't want to play with a silly, childish toy, why should we? Why should adults have to play with the same toys that little children play with? Little children should say to their adults, like, hey, this, I think this is really fun. You have to do it. And the parents say, ah, no, it doesn't really interest me, right? The adults will say that. It's the same thing. This world's just a silly, whimsical, capricious, nonsensical, wishful thinking, meaningless toy that, fear, the toy of fear, the toy of doubt, the toy of uncertainty. Why are we supposed to be interested in that? We're not. Okay? We're not interested in it, playing that silly games. We're tired of this. We're not interested in it anymore. So more and more, we just, let the world take care of itself, as all the gurus say that. Let whoever made the world take care of it. Let the world take care of itself. Don't give it any more thought. Rama Maharshi said, don't give any more thought to the play of the world at all. No more thought to it. No more attention to it at all. There's nothing there. Nothing of value there. And so the ability to do that doesn't come that easy to us, and so that's why I boycott so much stuff, because I know at some point I'll have to take my attention off the world, say there's no value here at all, unless the Holy Spirit says, well, you can get a little bit of help as far as familiarity goes out of this. That's possible. Something that has some echoes of the sublime to it. Okay. And really, there are faint echoes of the sublime everywhere here in this world. We can't totally get away from the sublime. We can't totally get away from the gentle glory of reality. We're just doubting it. We're just trying to doubt it. So this world presents a picture of doubt to us. That's all it is, a picture of doubt. Doubting our perfection. A picture of doubting our perfection. That's all that it is. And for me, it's even worse than most, because I hate forms. I hate filling out forms. I just try to avoid any paperwork at all. I hate paperwork. I don't think people should have to, there should be any paperwork at all in the world. None. I'm responsible, and other people, I trust them to be responsible. We don't need passwords and paperworks and all this stuff. All this stuff is constantly due to the fear and doubt and uncertainty that we have, and how we have to manage the vulnerability and all this nonsense. It's for me. I don't want a world where I mean, I don't get any mail. I don't get phone calls. I don't want to have anything to do with the world, and I don't want to sign any papers, and anything I've signed has been under duress, and so it's not binding to me at all. There's, in fact, no agreements that any of us have made are binding at all. All made under false pretenses, under duress, so to speak. There are no agreements in reality. Everyone's free. How could you make an agreement to not be free? That's ridiculous. What's the purpose of agreements? There's no purpose to it. There's no purpose to it. Again, it's to cast doubt on what we are. So I'm only here to tell people how to really free themselves from the world. By the way we do that is free the world from us. Not through our dying. That doesn't free the world from us. We come back. Freeing the world from me is, so you don't need the world, you don't really light, which is what the world's just light. Light, you don't need to pretend to cast doubt upon me, upon what I am. Free the world. And then you'll be free of the world. But see, since we are the one imagining the world, we have to be the one that frees it. There's nobody, no one can free it for us. God can't free the world for us. God created us free. We're free to imagine if we want to. God can't come in and say, you can't have the world. Of course not. Nobody can take this little toy away from anyone. But it's about to get really nasty, likely. There's a huge upsurge in doubt. Don't blame Trump for this. I know a lot of people try to want a scapegoat. That is a very narrow viewpoint that's going to cause you severe problems. No. I mean, it's the technology is the real bad guy in all of this. This hideous, hideous control system of more and more bureaucracy, more and more forms. I mean, someone just told me that nobody faxes anymore. We just had, everything keeps breaking. Okay, so our printer fax, it just fell apart. You know, no usage hardly at all. It just fell apart and stopped working. Everything's planned obsolescence. And so I had to fax something. I was testing the fax, and they said, well, nobody sends faxes anymore. Right, so it's like you're being forced to go along with this technological route, which is more and more bureaucracy, more in control, more and more numbers, passwords. You turn into a robot. You know, it's horrible. So it's technology that's the monster. Actually, I don't need any technology at all. Actually, I use it to try to inform people they don't need technology. We can go to a world where there's no technology at all. It's completely unnecessary. Technology is just being used to, you know, to distract us away from what we really are, and claim that we're a number to be manipulated. So, just having our car was just declared total today, and just having to go through all this hoops, is just crazy. I hate it. Absolutely hate it. You know, and I always say I'd rather not even be in this world at all. This world is not attractive enough to me to stay here. Because of technology. I mean, it's what's going on as far as technology goes is absolutely hideous, monstrous. And the future they have planned for us is monstrous. So I don't have any interest in the future of this world. What happens to it is not none of my concern, really. But of course, you look back and say, wow, you know, there was so many echoes of the sublime here in this world. Just the nature, you know, the plants, the grasses, the flowers, the trees, the nature. There's some echoes, faint echoes here, but not enough to stay here and suffer from this, you know, invasion of those who, you know, want to cast severe doubt upon themselves. Not at all. Jesus said, don't fear those who could kill the body, fear those who could kill the soul. What he really means is those who can entrap our attention, divert our attention really severely into thinking, you know, we're something that we're not. And that's what technology does. Technology is extremely regressive, very childish, silly nonsense, really. And I really can't stand it. I really am so sick of it. You know, just having to buy another printer to set it up, try to get phone lines working. One phone line is dead. You know, it's for the 10th time, you know. It just never ends. The glitches never end. And it distracts us from focusing in on the fact that we can ascend. There are many places we can go. In fact, infinite places we can go. We're not trapped in this world. If anyone with even a little bit of integrity would question the idea that somehow we're entrapped. How could spirit be entrapped anywhere? How could freedom be entrapped? We're free to experience whatever we want to experience. Everyone is. So we have to reconsider our situation, really. And I'm running out of patience. You know, I've been trying to tell people my whole life that things are going to get really bad, and you need to choose a different location. Really, I have zero interest in remaining here in this world. It's just pathetic at this point. It's all pathetic. It's so pathetic. By design. So those who want to doubt themselves, try to doubt themselves so they can, those who want to cast doubt upon what they are, so they can believe that God isn't what God is, so they can believe they can be greater than God, that there's a competition is possible, and maybe they can win the competition. Let them play their silly, absurdist games. So it's meaningless, never, it's all manufactured fake evidence. We don't have to play that game. If they want to play it, I don't want to prevent them from it. I don't want to, not trying to, get rid of the world or anything like that. They can continue playing their idiotic games here if they want to. But why should I have to be a spectator to their idiocy, their absurdity? Why should any of us? It's one thing to, say that you want to do that. It's another to say that everybody else has to be spectators of it. What is that? It's like somebody, banging on a piano can't play at all. They say, everybody in the world, you have to listen to my piano playing, and you can't do anything else. Excuse me? That's trying to play God, isn't it? So for those who want to play God, let them try to play God. But we know that they're not God. They're not the prime creator who created us as freedom itself. They haven't changed our freedom at all. We're free to do whatever we want to do. We don't have to be a captive audience, but technology is trying to make us a captive audience to technology. We're supposed to be the audience for this dance of technology. I'm not interested in it. So I don't know. I leave the audience. You don't have to be a part of the audience. And then you'd say, well, how's that possible? Well, it's easy. You just set the world free from me. Give the world permission. Give the light permission. We can say the world, but it's really light. And just keep working on that. And I've made progress today on it, and we'll continue to. Just keep giving permissions. Go in that angle. So we're getting another car because it was a lease. So fortunately, we were able to get another car. But what a waste! It's just horrible. I don't like it. And all the technology in cars today, no. That screen, that LED screen, just dim it all the way down so you don't have to be, it's just a distraction. The mirror, the turning camera, all this stuff, there's way too much technology in cars. A lot of people don't like it. A little bit of technology was fun for a flirtation, but now it's just ridiculous. Okay, it's pathetic. Obviously, they can't think of anything else to do with their, with their life experiencing except more code, more technology, pathetic. They could spend time on the spiritual path, coming to the realization that there is no quote-unquote world binding anyone. Nobody's bound at all. Nothing is bound except to freedom, the experiencing of freedom through the loss of reality, the way reality is, all is bound to that. But other than that, there's no bondage at all. So the same people who are fleeing the country because of Trump, they give themselves the right to leave a situation they don't like, but they're the same ones who insist that you can't flee this world. I mean, what hypocrites, okay? What utter hypocrites. This world is just as fleeable as anything else. And we've got this consensual delusion that somehow we're in bondage to this world. That's like you're saying you're in bondage to a dream. You can't flee the dream. Like you can't, let's say you're having one dream world and you say, well, you can't leave that dream world. Why? Just go to another dream world. I mean, what do you mean you can't flee? Or wake up from the dream, ultimately. But I mean, they say they're all championing the refugees fleeing war, okay? Well, technology is a million, you know, infinitely worse than war, actually. And they say we can't flee technology. And just this whole world is just a world of distraction and generated to create doubt, a world of death and fear. They're saying we can't flee that. We can't be a refugee, take refuge from that. What are they talking about? It's just utter hypocrisy. You know, just they don't have a clue. And Jesus left this world, didn't he? He left alive, didn't he? He ascended into the clouds, and they said, "Where you go? Hey, you can't leave." They said, "You can't leave," and he says, "You know, I'm going to prepare a place for you." And he said, "What are you talking about? This isn't my world. This isn't my kingdom. This is not the kingdom of heaven. You know, this is a fallen world. This is the world of the prince of darkness. I'm not staying here. What are you talking about?" And they thought that he had no right to leave. You can't leave. So I guess they were a little bit surprised when he left. And they've been trying to hold on to his, you know, crucified body ever since. Say, no, you can't leave. Can't leave. Well, of course, no one can leave the mind, the one mind, right? But as far as our experiencing goes, we can experience whatever we choose to experience. So the real refugee situation is from this monster of technology, actually, and how it's completely invasive, you know, just the most invasive weed imaginable, right? Nobody can put any limits on it. Well, sayonara, you know, goodbye to that. The world is a suicide cult, actually, and they're saying we can't leave a suicide cult. You know, it is it not? Does it not everyone come here to die? Isn't that a suicide cult? Because everything's a choice. As Jesus said, all death is suicide. Period. You have to choose it for yourself in order to die. That's why Jesus said he agreed to die. He chose to die. Otherwise, he said, if it weren't given to you as a choice, you couldn't touch a hair on my head. So he chose the body to die. Then he chose for the body to be resurrected. Simple as that. So all death is 100% a choice. So those who come into this world, they're insist nobody can leave. That's a cult. You know, he's saying you can't leave this belief system. And the cult is a suicide cult because they're coming here to die, to commit suicide. So they're saying we can't leave a suicide cult? Of course we can. But they cast all sorts of maledictions upon us, you know. So the Virgin Mary told you can't leave. You know, what do you mean? they try to. The first lie that they tell you is that the Virgin Mary said that this is legitimate, or Jesus said this is legitimate, or someone said this is legitimate. Right? This is the truth. You know? And if you leave, you know, she'll be hated forevermore. Just, this is all just nonsensical stuff that fear is making up. Fear of familiarity, continuity fear, makes this all up. That we're bound here and all this nonsense. Utter nonsense. And yet it's consensually, since everybody acts as if they are bound, we think it's some sort of law, that's true. Just because everybody acts that way, but not everybody has acted that way. I mean, there have been a number of our brothers who have just ascended out of here. Shankara, you might say, Jesus, certainly, Chaitanya, Sri Chaitanya, all the Tibetans with light bodies, rainbow bodies, for instance, even though they seem to die, they have a variation on that. I think Jesus in the Bible says Elijah or something maybe have ascended. And that throughout history, actually, there have been those who have just ascended, into another domain, another kingdom, another dimension from here, who just took their bodies, turned them into light, so to speak, or just, I don't know exactly, what happens, but they didn't buy into the nonsense of consensual whimsicality. Consensual whimsicality. Consensual meaninglessness. Because they're trying to tell themselves that they can't go. So they're trying to convince themselves. See, the problem is that those who are part of the suicide cult, we call a world, are trying to automate their doubt. And they feel that their happiness comes from automated doubt. So they don't want to throw any doubt on their doubt. You see, they think that's interfering with their happiness. And this is, completely insane. Absolutely insane. But that's how everyone here, that's how they really think. That's their belief. Is so if you leave, that casts doubt upon their doubt, doesn't it? Because they're saying, no, you can't leave. Nobody can leave. In other words, we're not free. We're not spirit. We're not free. Nobody's free. And they think that if this nobody's free becomes automatic, then it'll be a new reality, and then they'll be happy because they'll be the prime creators of this new reality. And then they'll just decree themselves happy, and there it is. This leaves out, all the facts. Totally. They think the facts are something they can just make up out of thin air. But casting doubt on doubt is what they really hate. They really hate it. That's why it's so difficult to get this message through anywhere. Is people just, they just say, I want to have doubt, easy doubt. My doubt is just automatic and easy. And many have worked on that to a great extent. That's what technology is all about, is trying to automate our doubt. So why would anybody with any integrity want to hang out in a place that's dedicated to automating doubt, automating the pretense of doubt? That's ludicrous. You don't want that. There's no value in it at all. Zero value. There's zero value in doubt. There's zero value in doubt. So I got a little irritated today for sure because the time is running short. I say, hey, Dharma Kings, we're talking about response now, okay, today. Now, but I was shown that they will show up exactly the right moment. So we still have some clarifications to go, apparently. But things are going really fast. We have to go very fast right now, Ferrari mode. The world's getting ready to have a great big doubt party. Great big doubt party. That's all that it is. And those who want to feast on this doubt will want to remain here and go through that. Christianity, of course, classic Christianity, it's all about the end times and Jesus returning and those who want to go with him, leaving this world, going to a different dwelling place that he's prepared. That's classic Christianity. That doesn't get emphasized very much anymore. And they don't want to have attend the doubt party. So I was boycotting the world. I've been boycotting for quite some time. It's just, I'm not interested anymore in what's happening in the world. It doesn't interest me. So I've had to take, you have to take concrete steps, real steps to do this. I, boycotted sports. The only thing that really kept me interested in the world was sports. That's it. That's how I stayed interested in the world, because the rest of it, I'm really not interested. And, but and also the sublime, I use that to try and get ready for some better realm. But as far as interest in what's going on in the world, sports, as but now I boycotted it. I've been boycotting it for about 16 months or so, or more than that, maybe. You see, Well, yeah. 17 months. Just no more. Well, baseball longer than that. I didn't follow it all last season at all. So, season started in April. Okay. Yeah, I boycotted that. I boycotted the basketball, baseball, everything. Football, boycotted. All sports, I boycotted. I don't pay any attention. I don't even know who's in the Super Bowl. I have no idea, and I don't care. I don't care at all. It's irrelevant. I don't care who wins, who loses, this or that in the world. It doesn't matter who's winning and losing. Music, I don't really care. Who makes what music anymore? Art, I don't really care. Politics, I don't care. You know, whatever, everything, I just don't care at all. Doesn't make any difference. Whatever it is, it is. It's all the same. It's all the same nonsense. Valueless nonsense. It's all under the umbrella context of doubt. Doubting what we are. Trying to doubt what we really are. Which is, you know, perfection. Absolute freedom and perfection itself. So, why be interested in that? I don't have any interest in it. But I try to look for the beauty everywhere. You know, I don't really identify so much. I just noticed separate things, like that's a tree or that's a shrub. No, it's just opportunity to see beauty, you know, to experience beauty. It's just, this is just a part of a one vast appearance. Interesting. I was looking around and I realized I don't really identify with labeling differences between there's a tree and there's some hedges and this is this and that. It's just, where's the beauty? Where's the beauty? Where's the beautiful light? Where's the beautiful play of light? It's really, what we're seeing is just light. Are we seeing tree light? Is that really tree light we're seeing? Is that really? No, it's just light. Reflective light. So these appearances are just ways of reflecting light. Not just from the sunlight, but internally, what also is, it's light. Everything is just light. In the chemistry of everything, so that's just all light. So I look at stuff as, you know, what is the play of light that is appearing here? What is the play of light? And can we, you know, be inspired by it to keep the inspiration going, so that we can choose a better experiencing this? It's not designed to cast doubt upon what we are, right? And God didn't cast doubt upon what we are. This is not God's doing. It's our doing in an attempt to be greater than God. Okay? This world's an attempt for us to be greater than God, to draw God into competition, to believe there's a competition, that God's not sure about being God. And so we say, well, maybe we are. Maybe God's wrong. Maybe we're right. You know, maybe. So doubt, doubt, doubt. And then we believe that we can be in competition and win the competition with God, and it will be the prime creator. This is what it's all about, what we're trying to do. It has to be repeated over and over so we get familiar with it. Familiarity is key. Familiarity is king, really, in terms of where we're at. So just at the right time, what I've seen is the Dharma Kings respond just at the right time, just at the right moment. But we have to be getting close. You talk to those who have some wisdom, they say, you know, we are getting very, very close right now. Indeed, we are. So everybody has the jitters. And people are just their minds are like preoccupied, right? Distracted, preoccupied, concerned. Up. Excuse me. And we're not deluded. Self-righteous religion and atheism are the two sides of the same coin, the coin of doubt. You know, what a lot of religion, self-righteous religion, says is completely wrong. That is the whimsical effort to be greater than God. God, you know, they say that God created this world, created human beings here in this world as a home for the human beings, and all that. That's utter nonsense. That's just trying to deify our own attempt to compete with God. God hasn't had nothing to do with it. God doesn't tell us what we have to do with our freedom. We're not human bodies. There's no human beings at all, actually. It's just an excuse we're using to try and doubt what we really are. So we identify with human bodies only as an excuse. When we identify with human bodies, it means we're trying to compete with God. That's all that it means. That's it. So people say, God created human beings. Well, that means they're trying to compete with God, plain and simple, and trying to win a competition, be greater than God. Fortunately, there is no competition. It's impossible to compete with all there is. What is outside of all there is to compete with all there is? Nothing at all. So there can't be any competition with God. It's not possible. So we're just getting this here to help everyone. It's been a rough week for me. Rough day. Somehow God's getting me through it in some way, you know. Wow. I just feel this urgency. I mean, we really need to get the ball rolling here. I'm ready to roll. My knee was better today, you know. Wow. Awesome. I did a tremendous amount of workout yesterday. I thought my knee would be hurting. Well, maybe tomorrow it will. Usually the second day it hurts, but it didn't hurt me at all today. It's still weak. I can feel it's weak, but it didn't hurt. That's good. Of course, you know, any pain is trying to cast doubt on what we are. That's it. I saw a man with a walker. It looks like he used to be an athletic man, and he's hobbling. It's like my age, or even less than my age, maybe. But he's just feebly hobbling along in the store. And I said, oh my gosh, it just doesn't look right. So what are you doing trying to cast doubt upon yourself like that? That's all you're doing. And that's all anyone's doing. There was this photographer, world-renowned photographer, who photographs sickness and illness and deformities and everything to show the other side of this life, you know. And when I look at those pictures, I just have to laugh. I say, what are you doing trying to cast doubt on yourself in such ridiculous ways? You know, that's all you're doing. Look at me, I'm so crippled and, you know, amputated arms and legs. I'm here. Why are you trying to cast doubt? All you're trying to do is compete with God. That's all you're trying to do. Jesus rebuked, you know, people who are sick. So get up and walk. It's gone. I cast out your attitude. Cast out your attitude. You know, stop trying to cast doubt upon God. Get up and walk. You know, leprosy, go. Go sin no more, Jesus would say, right? He'd say, oh, you poor thing, isn't it awful that God did that to you? No, he said, get up and walk and sin no more. Meaning, stop trying to compete with God. That's where your illness came from. Trying to cast doubt upon what you are. Since we're an idea in the mind of God, that's casting doubt, trying to cast doubt on the mind of God, which is God. It's obvious, isn't it? It has to be obvious. How could it not be obvious? We're an idea in the mind of God. Ideas in the mind of God never leave God, okay, the mind of God. Ideas always extend from their source. So if we cast doubt upon what we are, we're directly trying to cast doubt upon God, directly. because we're an idea in the mind of God. So we're trying to doubt God with all our sickness, all our dying, all this stuff is trying to doubt God so that we can come and believe we can get in competition with God. In other words, God isn't sure that God is God, right? Therefore, maybe we are. That's exactly what's happening here. And thank God we've been able to finally get to this explanation, because nobody else seems to be getting to this. I said, come on, are you kidding me? It's so blatantly obvious. But continuity fear blinds us. You know, that's all there is to it. When you get to it, you'll say, how could I not have gotten to that? It's so ridiculously obvious. It's continuity fear. It makes fools of us all. The issue of familiarity makes fools of us all. So don't hate on yourself or anyone else. You just have to keep working at it. You know, it. I mean, I feel like, how could it possibly take me so long to see this? Well, all this work I did, continuity fear. Yeah, it. I say, my gosh, I. But, and also the continuity fear of everyone else. It's not just my continuity fear. It's everyone in this world pressuring you to not see it this way. To be blind. To be blind. We're pressured into being blinded into a suicide cult here. That's all it is. But your continuity fear, you know, it's like a break. And it's just like, will it work out again? Maybe. What else is there to do on a rainy Friday night? Really? I don't know. Eat or work out. I think I'll just make a smoothie and work out. You know, why not? Keep the ball rolling. I did my 40 push-ups at the gas station today. Fast. I 40 fast. Okay. There's a big difference between resting kind of for a while, then do. If you rest for a while, then you can do 10, 15, 20 more, and then rest for a while, then some more. But it's when you do them just straight and fast, that's really gets you. I found that out. It's just like, wow. So I just, you know, do 4 sets of 10, and I don't stop. I try not to stop. And by the time I get to 40, I'm ready to stop. Now, if I take a little break, I can do 20 more, get to 60. But I haven't been able to just pump out 60 yet. It's possible. That's my goal for the winter here. By the time I exit the winter time here, I want to be able to at least do that 60 fast without stopping. Those are gas station push-ups with that U-shaped, you know, pipe they have to block at the end caps to block anybody running into the pumps. You just put your feet against the pump. The side of the pump, put your hands on that U-shaped metal hollow pipe that they have, and then just do push-ups on that. That's great. It's not too strenuous for you. And do it while you're gassing your vehicle. It's like the no-brainer. I mean, I'm the only one I've ever seen do that, and it's just like the best thing since sliced bread. Because what else are you going to do when you're filling your vehicle? You just sit there, you know, looking stupid. So why, well, you know, just waste your time. Well, of course, people now are like, they're texting or something on their phones. They think, oh, I'm doing something really important. No, do push-ups. Especially as you're getting older, you need to really watch your shoulders, your upper body strength. It disappears on you severely. It vanishes. Then you start getting shoulder problems. All sorts of issues arise. You become weak and feeble, and you got to keep working on you know, these gas. If everybody did these gas station push-ups, people would feel. There's nothing wrong with feeling confident about yourself, really. I you know, people are trying to find certainty. You know, in this world, we're all looking for certainty. We're just looking for it in the wrong places, mostly. You know, the people like who work out on their bodies and build them up real strong, but they're looking to feel. They want to feel certain. You know, about they want their body to be no doubt about it. I'm healthy. I'm strong. We're trying to get rid of doubt. It's the same people. That's what we're all doing. You look at anything, but they just don't realize that you can't have the wrong premise and reach the right conclusion. Really, right? You can't have a premise that 1 and 1 is 2, and I mean, sorry, that 1 and 1 is 3, and then make 3 the right answer. You know, it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. Reality doesn't work that way. So, But it's okay, you know, try to be healthy because we're trying to feel certain about something. Like we just want to feel certain about something, right? Because this whole world is just all uncertainty. Doubt, 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 doubt. We don't know what the next moment, you know, as far as what's going to happen. We're just assailed by constant doubts here. And so we try to beat it. You know, people are trying to be rich. They're trying to be certain about something. I got a lot of money. I'm certain about that. So, I mean, it's not like we're demonizing everyone's efforts. We just have to point out, you know, what is a truly effective effort? Set the world free of me. There is no me, actually. Me is just this imaginary self that has doubt. That is being assailed by doubts. The I, the me, is just made up by light. Light, of course, we can't doubt. We're spirit. We cannot doubt. But so we identify with this fake self that is assailed by all these struggles and vulnerabilities and doubts. Look at the body self, but it doesn't even have to be a body self, just a fake self. And then believe that we have doubts. That the only way we can do it is through a proxy self. The only way we can believe we have doubts is through a proxy self. So the body mind is a proxy self that light is imagining for us. But there isn't any me, really. So free the light from pretending that there's some me that has doubts, throwing doubts on a pretend me, pretend identity. Free light from having to present that to us by just setting it free. I set you free, light. You don't need to pretend anymore that there's a me. That there's doubt and that there's a me. And now you can reflect certainty. It's trying to rain a little bit, but it's just real kind of drizzly stuff. There's nothing that's going to cause any runoff. But we need to get light starting to reflect certainty to us, right? That's what we need. The play of light. We need that light. We really need for you to actually start doing this. And then we just start experiencing it. We know what it is. We don't need to explain anything. It's so simple. Explanations just make it too complicated, isn't it? I mean, I can explain this a little bit here, but it's so simple and cut and dried. There's no wiggle room at all. Just set the light free from trying to pretend that there's any doubt on a me. Okay? Any doubt on a me. It's a silly little toy. And set the light free. It's just being obedient to us, as always. So it's that simple. And then just enjoy the sublime play of light. So that's the videos that I do, nature videos, is all about this sublime play of light. In some way, I'm trying to convey that various ways, and those videos are very important because that's experiential. You know, I know most people like these videos. I mean, it's important to explain, but it's still concepts, right? It's still just concepts that we're talking about here, really. Just pointers. Concepts are just pointers. But the nature videos are more sublime in terms of the play of light. You can just kind of say, ah, that's beautiful. I hope the poppies are good this year. You never know. They haven't been really good since 2004. I don't believe. Because I've been checking it. Just every year has just kind of been subpar. I hit the one in 2003, I believe it was. Could have been either 2002 or 3. And that was worth seeing. That reminded me of, you know, the higher realms. That's for sure, because the superabundance, it just appearing out of nowhere. You know, it's just this desert wasteland. You drive through there, just scrub, ugly scrub. I couldn't believe when I heard there's like beautiful poppies. I said, ah, okay. So I'm driving there thinking, can't be that good. Just, you know, waste desert, dry desert wasteland scrub. It's this ugly area. And I'm driving along this highway, and I'm looking. I said, wait, what the heck? And it was just like the roads were lined with billions of poppies, just, and then it went on and on and on and on. It got better and better and better. I was just astonished at it. It was just extremely surreal. And out of nowhere, all these poppies appeared. You see, this is very different. They weren't cultivated. So this was very sublime. And I really, you know, want Jesus and the Dharma Kings to follow up on that now. You know, it's been 13 years almost. Jesus are, you know, 14 years, almost 15 years maybe since then. I mean, really? I mean, what are we waiting for? Seriously. But that had all the elements of, you know, a higher realm, a pure land realm, where whatever you want to experience, it just appears out of nowhere, so to speak. Just a light just manifests it. So these poppies, where did they come from? I drove through there before. There's no sign of any flowers at all. It looks like a wasteland. And now it's just suddenly the wasteland has been transformed into this unbelievably beautiful carpet, and the scent of honeyed scent of all the poppies, and you know, literally I had to stop and get out of a vehicle because I was so distracted I couldn't drive. And everyone was the same way. We said we're gonna have accidents, we're gonna hit somebody, we can't take our eyes off of these poppies. Everywhere you look, billions of poppies out of nowhere. So it's, you know, just at a gorgeous day, and so people were just out of their ordinary minds, out of their familiar. They left the familiarity, and you know what? Everybody handled it great. We were laughing, and we were very friendly with one another. Strangers, we were smiling, saying, "Hey, how you doing?" You know, all these strangers from all over the world were getting along beautifully. So I've experienced that because they were out. They were experiencing this, the sublime. They're being reminded of what they really are. They were being reminded of their spirit. Truly they were. How awesome is that, huh? That experience was one of the greatest experiences of my life, really. Hard to top anything that. It had it all. We didn't care about our vehicles. People just wandered away from the vehicles. They forgot all about. If you ask them, what kind of car are you driving, or vehicle, they, huh? I don't know. What's your name? My name? I don't care what my name is. Doesn't really matter, does it? And nobody would think to ask your name. See, nobody even thought, like, you know, where are you from? Or, no, I mean, you're just smiling and laughing and saying, oh my gosh, this is amazing. And you're here experiencing it with me. Thank you. And, you know, you could see how beautiful we all are, really, when we're in our right mind. People from all over the world, male, female, different ages, you know, everybody felt like this feeling of love for one another and supportiveness for one another. And it's like, hey, this is where it's really at. This is what it's really like. Okay, this is how it should be, right? Yeah. And we completely forgot about the world. The rest of the world just vanished. Time vanished. Future vanished, past vanished, the world vanished, names, labels vanished. None of that had any relevance at all because we are just soaking up this beauty and just saying, how fortunate I am to be here right now. This is just awesome. Wow. We were just totally in the wow. Everyone was in the wow. Just floating on clouds of wow. I had a recent experience that was similar with foam at the ocean. That was quite amazing, but it was different. But it was also, you just forgot about the world and everything else. It was just so amazing. It was so unexpectedly amazing. How could the beach look so beautiful, be transformed in such a beautiful way? Just like, how could the desert be transformed in such a beautiful way? Then we had an experience at the Death Valley that was similar. Of that place is, you know, really barren. I mean, just the most barren place in the world, you would think. But the rains were just right, and flowers just came out everywhere. It was just gorgeous. And we were just saying, oh my gosh, just knocked us out. And then there was a lake there with people kayaking in the lake. And that was so surreal. It just seemed to appear out of nowhere, all this stuff. That's what we really love. I don't like manufactured stuff really at all. Things. I don't like things. I like stuff that just appear. That's like, speaking of appearing, I'll tell you what's going on where I live is a miracle is going on. A miracle that I asked for. So this is really important to talk about this a little bit. Is in years gone by, I asked God for a miracle, a sign. God, when I believe it was like, you know, when you're ready to for Jesus to help us out and everything is going to go our way, send us a sign. I want the roses to bloom all year. I want the roses to bloom in winter. I want them to bloom in winter, God. And that was a number of years ago I asked for that, and it didn't happen. And I was really kind of like, oh, you know, God didn't listen. Well, guess what? Guess what? I checked in December, late December, okay, dead of winter, shortest day of the year, cold, rainy, you know, everything. I suddenly said, what the heck's going on? Because all the roses were in bloom, buds on all the roses. And we picked roses in bloom, put them inside, and they bloomed, opened up beautifully. I said, what's going on? I said, well, okay, that it's just an anomaly or something. Well, all January the roses have been blooming. And now it's February, and they're bursting out and bloom even more. And we have roses in the house that we've cut all winter, and they opening up and looking gorgeous. There's like, you know, 50 buds on this one rose. I mean, just beautiful rose buds all over our roses. And nobody else's roses are doing that at all. And I've told people, and they kind of go, yeah, that's really weird. I've never seen anything like it. And they shrug, and that's it. They don't realize that's a sign from God, that I asked for that sign. So we've been given a sign. And I you know, what about taking pictures? Sure. You know what? I found out that when you try to convince people against their will, you just create backlash. So it's not even worth it for me to do that. But you either believe what I'm saying or not. Okay, it's plain and simple. I'm telling you that this is what has happened. And it's not just one rose. The number, you know, pink roses, red roses, yellow. There's gorgeous blooms on this honey-colored rose right now. It's opening up, you know. But it did this all winter. In December and January, okay. And I've talked to people who are experts with roses. They know roses, and they just say, I don't know what's going on. I've never seen this before. I have no idea. Nobody has any clue how to explain it. Nobody. But I specifically asked for this miracle, for God to do this miracle in the years past. So, you know, if people can either believe that there's a correlation or not. But for me, of course there's a correlation. It's a miracle. God is just showing the light. God said, I'll set the light, I'll help you. Because since you asked for the light to be set free upon these roses, so the roses will bloom in winter, this has been done now. This is a sign showing you that you set the light free to bloom the roses in winter, and now it's happening. But the delay was like several years on it. Okay, so there was a, you know, several year delay in asking, you know, setting the light free until actually experiencing it. But that's kind of good news, because I've set the light free in a lot of ways, and just recently I've set it completely free. So maybe the delay is less now. But for me, I want everything to just be blooming all the time, and nothing to suffer, no sickness, no infirmities, everything just glorious always. And I set the light free to present that to me. I set the light free to present that to me. So God is saying, it will come, it will come. It's just your bias delays it a little bit. I have right above my desk 4 roses, gorgeous roses. Full bloom right now from backyard, from the roses we have. And there's nothing special. There's no greenhouse. We did nothing. I did nothing to the roses. I didn't fertilize them, didn't water them. I did nothing. I left them alone. We didn't trim them. Interesting. Ordinarily, we trim the roses. We have someone, you know, cut all the roses and trim them way back so they can. This year, we didn't do it. We didn't do it. But other years, we haven't done it also. But this year, we didn't do it. But a lot of people don't do that and they don't bloom. Right? So, people just shake their heads. And I've told a lot of people, they just, huh? Oh, yeah, that's weird. Wow. Huh. Wonder why. Did you, what did you, they say, well, what did you do to them? They never say, well, God must be a miracle from God. Nobody said that. Nobody has said that. It's a miracle from God because I granted myself that miracle. I set the light free from my experiencing of those roses. So that the light is not bound by this delusion of time, space, process, and form. Oh, it's winter. They can't bloom. There's no winter now for those roses. Okay, they're free to bloom all year round. It was just a convention. Everything here is just a conventional agreements that will consensual agreements about there's that things should appear in a certain sequence way, so we can infer that light is bound. You know, doubt that light is free. That we're free. And also the doubt that we're free. Yeah, you know, that's why we do it. So now the roses are showing me, reflecting certainty to me that I'm free, and the light is obedient to my freedom. That's what it's showing me. Yeah, it's interesting. I have these beautiful blue flowers. These are plastic ones behind me, but it symbolizes perpetual bloom. I'm very big on that. I feel that plants, when I walk by, should bloom. If I ask them to bloom, I feel they should suddenly be full of blossoms, just like that. Really, like those poppies, you just suddenly, you know, poppies just appear. That's how I feel. If you want to know how do I feel about the world, I feel everything should just be perfect. You know, that's I give the light the permission to show perfection to me constantly, and so I don't care what season it is. The flowers should be radiantly blooming and beautiful. Everything should be beautiful. Why should seasons have anything to do with it? Why should anything have anything to do with what we desire to see, what we tell the light, that's what we should get. That's reality. So this showed up in the way I asked it to show up. Super miracle. Super miracle. Super, super miracle. And again, I could take video of it, but people... If you don't want to believe it, you're going to come up with excuses, and then questions start. Say, well, wait a minute, maybe he's pulling a fast one. So if people want to disbelieve, it's better not to give many evidence. You know that? It's better not to try. That's what I found out. Don't even, because all you're going to get is a headache, because they'll never accept it. And they'll try to put you in a situation that makes you look bad. Then they'll start working on you, attacking you, trying to make you look bad and throw doubt upon you, you know. You know, shoot the messenger, so to speak, thing. That's what they do. So it's not worth it. But I'm just telling you, those of you of faith, ask for miracles and you shall receive. And you do that by setting the light free from casting doubt upon you. Because light didn't do this on its own. We asked light to give the appearance of casting doubt upon our freedom. We did this. And ideas don't leave their source. So we had this idea. So... we could change our idea and say, light, now I'll give you the idea of casting certainty upon me. Casting certainty upon me and gentle glory upon me. This is now the permission I give you, light. And it will show up. It will show up. And again, it took a couple years for that to show up. But that's the bias delay. Okay, the bias delay. It's not a process-based delay. It's bias delay. Very important. So we're talking nitty-gritty stuff here. It's timely, very timely stuff. A lot of saber rattling, trying to correct the wrongs of the past, all the appeasement of the past. I mean, you know, the path of appeasement is a worse path, isn't it? Because things just get worse and worse. You kick the can down the road, it gets worse and worse and worse, and then at some point you wake up and realize it's just atrocious. If Hitler hadn't been appeased so much, it wouldn't have been so bad. If they would have taken a hard line right off the bat, said, look, you do this, and that's it, you know. That's bad behavior, and we're going to respond. It would have been a different story. It would have mitigated a lot of stuff. Instead, they appeased, Neville Chamberlain, appeased. You can't, you know, that's just proven a very bad strategy. Very bad strategy when you know you have ideologues and you could read the tea leaves. You know what they're up to. You know they're trying to get every advantage possible here to cast as much doubt as possible upon you, and so appeasement is not good at all. So you have someone now who's saying, hey, you know, appeasement's over. That's the wrong way. Look, there's consequences. You try to do this, we're going to call you on it right now, right today. That's it. We're not going to tolerate this anymore. You're not going to go any further down that path. And then, of course, they got all freaked out, like, oh, you're a terrible, terrible person, you know. We wanted more appeasement. We thought you would appease us more so we could keep, you know, getting more and more advantage upon you. Well, too bad. Cry be a river. Come on. But it's all just the game of casting doubt here in the world, right? And miracles happen. The miracle of the roses blooming in winter. Have one right here. And I don't want people coming here and say, oh, gee, wow. Oh. You know, it's enough to just hear it from me. It's just enough. You know, if you trust in me what I'm saying, then you know what I'm saying is true. And then you can say, wow, that's tremendous, tremendous. And you can verify it in your own life. You will ask for miracles. They will happen if you really set the light free from casting doubt upon me. The I, casting doubt upon this. Really, it's imaginary me, but, you know, we could use figures of speech somewhat loosely here, because the key is to set the light free. Say, I chose a different idea for you, light. You don't need to keep pretending that I have any doubt of what I am, that there's any doubt at all of what I am, because that doubt of what I am would have to come from God, because God, I'm an idea in the mind of God. Therefore, any doubt of what I am must be coming from God, and that must mean that God doubts himself, or itself. God doubts itself. And that's just, you know, utter whimsical arrogance on our part. We're trying to compete with God then. That points out what we're really up to, is trying to usurp the place of prime creator. So just stop, you know, drop this silly notion, drop this whim. Say, I'm not really interested in doing that anymore. I understand the consequences, all this fear and mental illness and confusion and suffering and frustration and bias and, you know, familiarity problems, all this. It's hell. It's hell. And I don't need to keep residing in this hellishness, right? I don't need my attention to be there. We can set the light free. It's already free. It's responding to what we asked it to do. So we give it a different task, you know, reflects certainty. But light is not bound by any time, space, process, and form. There's none whatsoever. It's all just light. So it can obey instantly. But so what slows it down, its obedience down, delays it, is our bias against certainty. We want to feel that light had some doubt about doing it. It did it, but it took 2 years, you know, to think about it or something, or had to go through this process of 2 years. That's continuity fear, and that's okay, because we all have that severely. So the fact that something happened in several years' time, that's very fast. You know, that's fantastic. Now, the less continuity fear you have, the quicker the miracles occur. When Jesus, there's no continuity fear, so he you know, walk past the lepers and they're all healed. He did it instantly. Right? He might have done a little stuff to help people have faith, like, you know, make some spit in some clay, make a little clay and put them over the blind man's eyes, as if something was, some process needed to happen. But, you know, he came to Lazarus, says, Lazarus, get out of the grave. People say, but he's been there for days. You know, he's a rotting corpse. Lazarus, stop pretending to be dead. Get up and walk. Walk out right now. And Lazarus did. He said, you know, Jesus said, okay, you know, go and sin no more. He says, come on. Stop pretending. He rather said, yeah, you're right. You're right. You're right. You're right. I was just pretending. You're right. Right? That's Jesus. That we're all like that. It's just that Jesus, the only difference between Jesus and us is continuity fear. Bias against certainty. Jesus had no bias against certainty at all. So he could, said, mountain move, it would move instantly. You know, but we say roses bloom. I said roses bloom in winter, and it took a couple years. Still a miracle, right? To the most people's way of looking at it. But to me, it's just cause and effect is all. I freed the light from the atrocious pretense that what I am, there's some doubt of what I am, which is instantaneous, synchronicity, simultaneous, instantaneous, simultaneous, spontaneous experiencing. Absolute freedom. Again, go fast. I found documenting is a waste of time. I'm not going to worry about documenting my miracles. You know, forget it. I will comment and say, yeah, this happened. But because people who want to have cast doubt upon themselves, they'll find another way. They will continue to do so, and they'll actually be very aggravated that you documented and proved it to them that this was a miracle. They'll say, ah, now I've really got to get sick or something, you know, to cast more doubt on myself. Yeah, that's what happens. That's what they do. And if they don't want to believe, let them not believe. Don't try to force the issue upon anyone. And those who have repented and are working on this, they'll believe. They'll say, yeah, I know what you're saying is true. I believe what you're saying. Without any need for any evidence or documentation, actually. I try to talk about the miracles of like Sri Sri Nandabhaiman. Nobody, hardly anybody cares at all. Most people just, I said, why'd I waste all my time trying to document it and point out to people? And I've had almost zero response. There's maybe a few people, but other than that, nothing. They don't want to hear it. Bums them out. They said, I thought this world was like getting really, really like a safe refuge from certainty. And I don't want to hear about somebody coming here and showing that doubt is all just make-believe. They don't want to hear it. They get angry about it. It upsets them. And just any certitude at all upsets them. That's why you have to play the fool here. I used to be able to tell people what was going to happen in the future. I already saw it. This is coming. I'm sure about it. Certain. They hated it. They said, no, I want to doubt. I want my future to be full of doubt. I don't want to know what's going to happen. And they don't want to know about reincarnation. They say, no, I want to doubt. I want to doubt. I don't want to know. I want to feel like, you know, I don't know. Well, they want freedom, but what they really want is they actually want doubt. They want doubt to be automated. Automatic. Without having to make any effort. They want it to be the reality. It's like freedom is our reality. It's automatic, no effort on our part. We're trying to have doubt to be automatic with no effort on our part. As if it's the new reality. Doubt, the new reality. And then they say, we'll be happy. Well, we'd be doubting that it's the new reality, wouldn't we? So how can we find happiness in doubt? It's obviously impossible. Doubt has to doubt that it's doubt. So even if we say it's a new reality, the new reality is doubt? Well, then doubt is going to doubt the new reality. Well, doubt that it's the new reality. Even if it was possible. So it's absurdity. It's absurdity to say that we can find happiness in that way. So all illness can be vanished like this. Jesus made just illness vanish. He said, stop trying to cast doubt upon yourself in that way. It's ridiculous. And boom! I mean, they got healed instantly. The blind could see instantly. The leper, gone. The leprosy, gone. The dead, raised from the grave. The crippled, the lame, up and walking like they never were crippled at all. Instantly. And any of us could do this. Any of us can do this. But we have the bias against certainty because of continuity fear, so we don't do it so instantly. And I get upset. I say, you know, I want you to be full of music. You know, I want to hear chimes from every leaf. You know, I want every leaf to be this beautiful little wind chime. Actually, you know, it is already. I want to hear it though, but I want everything to be full of fruit and full of blossoms and flowers and beautiful all the time, or whatever, you know. Palm trees, I want you to sway in the breeze and give off a beautiful melody to me. You know, I want everything to just be blissful when I walk by. And it doesn't happen. And I say, what's wrong? Well, bias, continuity fear, the bias against certainty is what's wrong. Otherwise, it would happen. I'm sure of it. It would happen. And I talked to the nature. I said, nature, you know, what are you doing? I'm telling you, you don't need to do this for me. You don't need to go through the cycles of death and all this kind of nonsense, you know. I told you to bloom. Why are you not blooming? I really feel like this is really odd, but it's the bias. I had to try to figure out why. It's the bias. And of course, it's not just my bias. It's everyone's bias. They don't want to see it. They don't want to see it. So I believe Jesus told us there's a way around that. Is it will have subtle, to spiritual sight, it will be blooming. But he doesn't want us to like make it bloom for our physical sight, because other people freak everybody out, and then they'll make themselves sick to try and reinforce their doubt. Okay, so what we need then is spiritual sight to see it blooming, to protect other sensibilities, their continuity. If it's so severe, it'll freak them out. So we could walk by a tree or a shrub or whatever, and with our spiritual sight, see it perfect and blooming beautifully. This is what Marie Watts saw, the saint, Marie Watts, California saint. Her spiritual sight was open, and so she would see trees that, like, might be some trees, you know, in the forest that are, you know, broken down, looking ugly, and they get sick. Okay, sneeze tried to hit me. But she'd shift into spiritual sight, and the tree would be this gorgeous, beautiful tree in full health. So she saw everything in perfect full health when her spiritual sight was, when she shifted into that. And we can do the same. We can easily do the same. So everything we see can appear to be beautiful and healthy and just, you know, flawless. Whereas others will look at it and it'll still seem dead, because they're asking for the light to make it to cast doubt upon what they are. We're asking for the light to cast certainty upon what we are. And certainty means everything, really perfection and beauty and glory is what we really want. So what the light would appear to cast itself in that light. But we still want familiar forms around. So we see this shrub here, and instead of, you know, being winter and the shrub looks kind of sickly and stuff, it will appear to be just like perfect, like the healthiest, most beautiful shrub you've ever seen. And we can see everything that way, actually. Everything. Marie Watts did. Thank God. Thank you, Marie Watts. Great Dharma gratitude to you for writing books about it and being honest and saying, this is how I see the world. You know, I can see it this way. I can shift. She said she's looking outside her window and seeing this sickly tree that got hit by lightning. It was all broken and shattered and stuff in her yard or something. And then she suddenly shifted, and she saw it as just gorgeously beautiful, perfect tree. And she said could see this the way for days. You know, she could sustain it. She sustained it. Why not? And I always wanted to have that. I read Marie Watts when I was young, and I said, this is what I want. I want this for me. I want this. I really want this. This is how it should be for me. And I couldn't understand, why isn't this way for me? And it's just continuity, fear, bias. You know, I absolutely believed her when she, in her books. I said, yeah, that's what it should be for all of us. We have the right to do that. And people say, well, draw painting. No, because that, you know, that's doubt. And that's somebody who wants to doubt. And that would just irritate them, actually. I said, now, if you want it, then work on the spiritual path and you'll get it. Okay? Nothing's going to stop you from getting it. I don't need to represent it to you. And they say, well, if you can't take a picture of it, it doesn't exist. No, that's not true. Because you're using spiritual sight, which is a different type of perception than sensory perception, in order to safeguard the fearful ones of their sensory perception, their desire to doubt. We don't want to try and take that away from them. So if we want to see an ugly world, I'm not here to beautify that world for you. You have a right to it. Okay, I'm not trying to trespass on anybody's perception at all. It's just I have a right to see it as gorgeous and beautiful. Okay, I have that right also. Because whatever arises is in our experience, in one mind, you know, we have a right to. If we want to see it as ugly and sickly and vulnerable, we have that right to imagine that. But we also have the right to have it cast certainty upon us, too. So you see this palm tree, and you just be everything just be gorgeous. Gentle glory everywhere. It's funny, I opened up this video recording program yesterday, and it always says AVS video recorder. That's what it says right down there on the little tab on the bottom. And I opened up this time, and it said, Manjushri, gentle glory. That was yesterday. Manjushri, gentle glory. I said, what? Where did it get that? I don't, you know, it's like, wow. It was great. So now we have the whole science behind, the spiritual science behind spiritual vision. Man, again, I understand the spaciousness of Longchenpa talking about that. That's maybe even further, in terms of seeing it that way. But I also understand Marie Watts and the visionaries, the mystics, Meister Eckhart and Rudolf Steiner and various people would see nature in this perfect way. Yeah, we have a right to that too. Absolutely, we do. They saw these beautiful light forms of plants and everything. It was perfect. There's no processes harming them at all. There's nothing, no lack of sunlight. I mean, there's something, in the all shade and deformed. No, everything's radiantly beautiful. And you could even have the plants give off fragrance and give off light, show beautiful dance of light, and you can have them give off sound also, gorgeous sound. Absolutely, you can. Just set the light free from casting any doubt upon me, upon what we are. Just give light permission to do that, and it will do that. Now, maybe not instantly because of the bias, but head in that direction. I've been heading that direction my whole life because I said, I know this is possible. I know it is possible. And I believe Marie Watts, what she said. She's very, very full of reason and full of clarity. And she didn't contradict herself at all. She's extraordinary, extraordinary mind. There's no reason to doubt what she said. And the mystics throughout history, there's no reason to doubt these mystics. They're saying this is their, they call it the mystic vision. Well, yeah, but here, I want to take the mysticism out of it. It's just straight science, spiritual science, 100%. You set the light free to reflect certainty upon you. And light is obedient. That's what it'll do. There's nothing more to it than that. There's nothing more to it. There's no need for any third eye, kundalini, energy, all that nonsense. Forget all that nonsense. You don't need any explanation to involve any of that stuff. It's just direct. It's just direct. You just ask for it. Ask, Christian, ask and you shall receive. It's that simple. But again, our bias against certainty because of we're so familiar with doubt, we want to doubt the results for a while, so the results don't come right away. And the more doubt you have, the more the results seem delayed. They're not really delayed. We're just asking it to appear as if it were delayed because of our familiarity with doubt. We're jittery if anything happens too quickly, as far as mystical, vision. We're jittery about it. Well, thank you, God. Thank you for bringing this information to light. I was feeling kind of irritated today, so we really need to get going faster. We know here comes the news. There's no time to lose. I was listening to that song all day, "The Parking Lot" by the Beach Boys. In the parking lot, something like that. And here comes the news. There's no time to lose. Ooh, like that. And it's like, yeah, here comes the news. There's no time to lose. That's it. That's a mantra. That's a mantra. So it's great that these videos are recording now. I really felt like I was going to have to quit. And, seems like they're doing good. I got this. I returned the microphone, and the guy I returned to was like this computer nerd, totally. I asked him, "Are you an audio expert?" He goes, "No, I build computers." He was explaining to me what the problem was. I said, "What was wrong with that?" He said, "Hum." He goes, "Ah." So, well, the old motherboards weren't shielded, so you get the sound interference from the digital interference to the analog of device here, and so you're going to get all this the modulation and hum and stuff like that. He said, "What you need is a DOC, a digital obstructing clearing something DOC or something. It's an outboard thing that you put between. He said, put it between the headphone, the microphone, and the motherboard, and then that cleans up all the stuff. That's what they do in professional studios and stuff. That's what you got to do." I said, "Well, I don't want to do that." And he says, "Well, you need a new computer with a new motherboard that helps shield so that you don't get the whole hum." And I said, "Dude, I said I have this headset here, which is realistic from Radio Shack, which is I don't know how old, maybe 6, 7, 8 years old or whatever. And I can figure it into mono because one of the wires is I got broken or something. And there's no hum at all. It works great. Old, it works great. It works. The newer stuff is, he said, that's USB, huh? It didn't work, huh? He was like really like hacked off about it. Like, you need to make all these adjustments to make it work. I said, why don't you just make this simple headset that works beautifully, that's older. But I told him that he couldn't relate to that at all. No. You need to buy new stuff. You need to upgrade the stuff. Get this, all this complex stuff. And here I just finally found some configuration. Default, you shift it over to mono. Works perfectly. Well, there's a little echo on it, but he didn't like that. It didn't register. Like simplicity can work too, He didn't understand what I said to him. It didn't process at all because he's so set on these computers. The nerds just always the next innovation, the next innovation, the next innovation. No, we'll fix that with this, we'll fix that with that, and we'll go with another problem with it. The simple solution evades them. It evades them because they want to cast doubt on what they are. And what we are is complete simplicity. What we desire to experience, we experience. It's all simultaneous. It's all spontaneous, simultaneous, synchronous, completely. There's nothing to it. There's no time, space, process, or form to it whatsoever. None. Never has been, never will be. There isn't any right now. Actually, as I said, everything's paranormal. There's no time, space, process, or form taking existent at all. It's just we're inferring it, the plausibility of it, so that we can cast doubt on our freedom. But it's not here. It's not existent at all. So again, everything's paranormal completely. And we can have paranormal perception. Again, as out of compassion, we don't, it's like, yes, well, why didn't Jesus go around and making everything bloom in winter? Well, he did occasionally stuff, but out of compassion, you don't want to scare people. That would scare the heck out of people, and they get really, really angry and fearful and find some way to doubt themselves, even more severely, like get cancer or something. They'd be so upset about that. Jesus would calm the water, storms raging, he'd calm it. Well, the apostles were freaked out. It was like, what the heck? It cost him a lot of severe strain. But he didn't just go around doing that to just willy-nilly to everybody. No. No way. That would be very, very uncompassionate to everyone. So, this idea like, oh, well, if you're a saint, do all these miracles, is nonsense. You don't just indiscriminately go around doing miracles like that, healing people. If it was given for them to be well, Jesus would tell them it was given for you to be well, so that's why you got well. That, for the purpose of showing this, but, and then, more to the point, Sri Srinandamayya used to go around healing people, and then she backed off from that. But what Ram Maharshi never really did that at all, but people still got well. But what they would do is they'd say, you're already healed, but your bias, let your bias play a little bit for you. That'd be good for you. So maybe in a couple of months you'll be well. And that's what would happen. Sri Srinandamayya would do that. She'd say, take this flower with you in remembrance of me, and in a couple of months your illness will clear up. Like that. That's all. And so that allows their bias to come into play, and then they're okay with it. They say, okay, that feels okay with me. In a couple of months, oh, it's gone. Oh, okay, I'm okay with that. But if you did it instantly, they would freak out. They might accept it for a little while, then the backlash would come. Their continuity for backlash would come. And they would get themselves even sicker, say, the next time I'm not going to let anyone heal me, They're like that. I'll get an illness that nobody can heal. So, so don't, try to mock saints into doing all these miracles. It doesn't work that way. But coming in contact with a saint, with faith that you'll be healed because of that, you will be healed at some point. You'll get well. Yeah, absolutely. It may not even be this lifetime. You may die, but next lifetime, the samskaras, the karmas of that, you'll find that it will dissipate and disappear if you have faith in that and want it to be so. Want it to be so. Yeah. or it might be this lifetime, or it might happen soon, or in the rare cases it might happen instantaneously. It's possible. It's all the same. It's all the same. Getting a little chilly out here. I thought this was lost. I found it. Oh, great. I have a hat that kind of matches this. I'm looking forward to. It's still dirty, though. This really stains badly. I'll have to work on that some more. It's okay. You can have the stains removed, too. Have light remove the stains. Anything. Anything at all. Everything's paranormal. There's no normal at all. It's all paranormal. It's all the play of light doing exactly what you ask it to do. But we do factor in compassion here for those who are so used to doubting themselves, they just can't cast that all away instantaneously. They would freak out over it. And some might do so for a moment, and then suddenly say, "What?" They'd say, "What in the world was I thinking? Crazy!" And get all scared and freaked out. So we don't, we're not aiming to, again, make some tree. I'm not aiming to walk down the street and have everything burst into bloom so others can see it with their sensory perception. I am aiming to walk down a street and see everything in perpetual bloom with spiritual vision. Absolutely, I'm aiming for that. But, you know, people say, well, you know, I don't see it. Of course not. Out of compassion, I don't want that. I'm not asking for light to do that. Because you would feel like you're being attacked. People would feel as if I'm attacking them. But by me seeing it, at least I'm not trying to attack myself, my own certainty. Okay, if you want to try and attack your certainty through doubt, you're free to do that. But I don't want to attack my certainty. So I want to see certainty reflected to me, without trying to force it on others. You see, like that. So Sri Sri Anandamayi died, had the body die. She made it very clear that her body didn't have to die. Everybody knew that. They said, Ma, look, we know you could keep your body perpetually young forever if you wanted to. She says, yeah, that's true. I could. But you all want me to die, so I'll let the body die. It's nothing to me at all. She said, I don't even see myself as a body. I see myself as this golden light. So if you want to see me a body dying, then you're fine. It doesn't bother me one bit. So she did. That's what they wanted. But didn't have to. And some would see her as completely youthful. And she was old and infirm. Even then, sometimes she'd do stuff that like only a young person could do, and then go back to appearing to be old again. If someone had faith in her, faith in God, she would show that to them. Like, yeah, I can be young. You can see me as perfectly young. That's perfect. And she said, that's fine. Yeah. Why? You have faith in God. Faith that God is certain, and that you are an idea in the mind of God, and you decided not to cast doubt upon that because I inspired you to that. She said, that's fine, that's great. And so they would see her as like young, perfectly young again, and without any infirmity whatsoever. Yeah, they would see her that way, sometimes for days, until gradually their bias began to creep back in. Or they could have seen her that way all the time. She said, as you see me, so what am I? I am whatever you see me as. Great answer, huh? They'd ask her, who are you? What are you? So I'm whatever you take me to be. I'm whatever you take me to be. Wow. Talk about a saint. Super saint. Super certainty. Not biased against certainty at all. Super, super saint. Could she do any miracle? Yes, she could. That saint could have done any miracle. Can do any miracle now. And did some. You know, did quite a few, but she didn't talk about it or anything. Your faith wanted this to happen, and it did. Your faith in God allowed this to happen, so I just... instrument of showcasing your certainty to you, that's fine. She took a cobra bite, you know, probably quite a few times. She took all sorts of stuff on herself, and nothing happened to her. and she saved someone else from getting from dying from it. In other words, casting doubt upon what they truly are in that silly way. And they said, "You're going to die. What are you doing? You're going to die." Oh my gosh. She says, "No, no, 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 no. Everything's fine." And they looked, and there was just like a faint little red area, and went away, and you know, just like that, she could dissipate any illness. Like, not a problem. Not a problem. If people's faith was such that it pulled that into experiencing. But didn't try to force anything on anyone. Absolutely no desire to try and show off and say, "Hey, look what I can do." None. That's why if some son of a devotee fell in a well and died, they were so angry with her. She said, "Well, that was his karma. He wanted to cast doubt upon his perfection in that way." Okay, that's what karma is, just casting doubt upon our, trying to cast plausible doubt upon our perfection, our freedom. And they said, "Why'd you allow it?" Because that's how he wanted to do that, to try to cast doubt on his own perfection. And his karma was such that if I tried to interfere and stop him, he would do something even more drastic to cast doubt upon himself. And they were really upset with her for a while. And finally, they came back to her and apologized and said, "We're really sorry. We understand what you're talking about now." It's not easy being a saint here, right? People expect you to you know, do all these miracles and protect them, but sometimes it's not called for because it may be like a positive karma. One thing, casting doubt in a certain way is to avoid casting doubt in an even more severe way. See what I'm saying? So you allow whatever happens to happen, and someone may die, but they're dying in a certain way that actually was much less casting of doubt upon what they truly are than if they had died in some other way. Okay? Get this? And God bless the Dharma Kings for giving us this information and clarity, you know. I was very irritated. I was sort of angry with Sri Sri and my Ma and Jesus and saying, you know, "Come on, I know you can do better." I was just telling them, "Look, you got to do better. You got to do better. You know, we're up against it." And they have. They've given us this clarity in this video. They've done a fabulous job. Fabulous job. So God bless you, Dharma Kings, for helping us out like this. And I told them, "Look, I'm just irritated. Don't take it like I'm hating on you. I expect more out of you. You know, we want more, and we need it now. And I'm just irritated. You know, so it's a positive thing. I wouldn't be yelling out if I didn't trust them and believe they could do better. You know, it's a sign that I feel, you know, you can do more. I know you can do better. That's all it is. But sometimes I get irritated. Like we're in a hurry here. You know, stuff's getting, you know, it's starting to hit the fan, isn't it?" And so they've done a fabulous job here with this video. Yeah, it's been recording. Great, I have to check it. Oh, 1 hour and 33 minutes, are you kidding me? What time is it? Oh, I started this one early. That's great. It's still a little bit light outside. Even it's like almost 6 o'clock. It's staying lighter longer now, which is great. I'm really happy about that. Powered through this winter. It was the winter I knew I had to power through, and thank God for everything. And for all of you, and being able to power through this winter, because I knew this would be a winter of vulnerability, where you know I could really fail. And I started the work on this in 2015, August of 2015. I started preparing for the winter of 2016, 2017, actually. So I had more than a year to prepare for it, and I worked every single day, and you know, got in shape and did so much stuff in every which way so I could power through the winter of 2016, 2017. And that's what we're doing here. We're powering towards spring now, actually. You know, got to keep at it because in California here, we've got like, you know, a lot of cloudy, a lot of windy, rainy, cloudy, blah sort of days ahead of us, it looks like. But it'll find some way to be beautiful, believe me. California. And I asked light, I told California, you don't need to cast any doubt upon me anymore, California. You're free to just be, cast certainty upon me. And it will do so, I'm sure it will. It's already done some wonderful things for me, California, the beauty that it's shown me. That the day of the beach, all the foam was just, you know, I'm still speechless about it. And also the low tide and the beautiful sheets of water in different directions. Again, I'm still speechless. I should just pump out a whole bunch of videos for you. People just don't seem to watch them, but maybe at some point they will. At some point you will. You made something go back and say, you know what? I want to watch this. And I should put some playlists so you can locate these videos too. Right? I know it's tough, but it's better if you can as they come out. Every day I go to like Surfline every day or Magic Seaweed, and I watch the videos, surf videos that come out every day. Because I know they're coming out with great stuff every day. I mean, every day there's a like whole bunch of new content. It's amazing what they do at Surfline.com and MagicSeaweed.com. There's always this really gorgeous scenery and waves, videos, surf videos around the world. Every day there's new stuff. Yeah, the music is horrible. The surf culture, it's pretty grungy, pretty gnarly and grungy. I can't stand most of the music. It's just terrible, I think. And the people's sensibilities are pretty rough and ready, folks. The surf dogs, the rough and ready folks. And so, but the lensmen, they're taking this stuff. They're doing a great job. It's beautiful how they do it. It's really, really nice. So there's a contest now for the beautiful, most beautiful photos of the year. I think it's on Surfline, and there's a winner for every month. Now they're trying to pick the best of each month there. And I went through a slideshow of them, and wow, gorgeous photos. Very sublime. You got a lot of people out there taking a lot of, gorgeous pictures. That is true. There's nothing wrong with that, okay? But leaving out the theory that I've given you here in this video, you're still going to come up short. You're really going to come up short. You're shortchanging yourself. You're still leaving yourself in the jaws of doubt. The hideous jaws of doubt. So I have both. I have both the clear, the clarify the theory and the sublime. Both. Both. Why don't we do both? I could do both. I'm doing both. Both sides of the coin. But I appreciate those who, provide beautiful content. I really do. Very grateful for it. But that doesn't mean that they understand how to set the light free. They don't. They don't. I've got the cart, but not the horse. So they're still stranded. Just like Jesus said, a healthy body doesn't mean that you've, truly repented and set the world free. It doesn't not mean that. The correlation goes in one direction, he says, not two directions. It doesn't mean that you've chosen to not cast doubt upon yourself. Because you may get some horrible illness at any point, just because you have a healthy body right now doesn't mean you keep it that way. You'd maybe just be setting yourself up for severe doubt, right? Yeah, you may still be identifying with the body, as something that to cast doubt upon yourself with. But there's nothing wrong with having a healthy body and being in shape. There's nothing wrong with that. I don't want to try to make people feel guilty about that. I've tried to be in look good and be healthy and in great shape, Yeah. I've been down so badly before, I want to be in shape. I feel like I can dance, dance around, dance down the street. I don't want to be all sick and old and infirm. No. Why? It casts doubt on perfection. It does. That's what purpose of body is, to cast doubt upon ourselves. But we can give the body a different purpose. As Jesus said, the body can function perfectly as long as we want it to bless and to heal and with compassion and to help people with certitude and spread the gospel. He said the body can perform absolutely perfectly for that purpose as communication device. No sickness, no fatigue. Just dancing your way through this hellish realm of doubt, Absolutely it can. And he says it will. And I believe what he says. There's no reason at all to disbelieve it. The science, the facts behind it are pure and clear. Now, will I do that? I'm working towards it. I'm working towards it. I may allow some of that. Yeah, I saw this 85-year-old man recently. I was 84 or 85, but he looked like, you know, 50-something. Most 50-year-olds look worse than him, and he still says he feels great. He said, I guess I'm just lucky. Oh, yeah, no, you're allowing that. You're allowing it. And that was just a heads up for me. He said, hey, you know, you might be able to allow yourself to be very, very healthy and fit. Except my eyes are lousy right now, but I can shift to, you know, spiritual vision and see I don't even need my eyes, physical eyes at all. Not in my mom said she never, didn't even use her physical eyes to see. Not at all. My eyes right now, my physical eyes are terrible. I mean, I'm getting worried, like I'm not going to be able to see anymore. They're so bad. I have trouble, really a lot of trouble. But that's why another reason why I'm in such a hurry. I say, hey, you know, my eyes are going bad fast, and I need spiritual vision in a hurry here. But she said, you don't even need to use the body's eyes to see. Not at all. And for her, she could see perfectly in pitch darkness. She said she doesn't see any darkness at all. Didn't even use the body's eyes to see. Everything was, she said, was lit up perfectly and beautiful because she was using spiritual sight to see light, casting no doubt, but reflecting certainty upon what reality is. So everything is luminous, self-luminous, and always is always lit up, always optimally beautiful, full of light, full of beauty. And so she walk around pitch darkness, she could see everything perfectly clear, as if it was, she said, I see everything as if it's noonday sun, even brighter than that. I don't ever see any darkness at all. You don't even need to see shadows either. Some say that she didn't cast any shadow. I don't know. I've never gone to look and see if that's the case. But I imagine that she would allow her shadow to be cast just because they don't want to freak people out. You know? It's the compassion of saints. They're not trying to show off. They're just being compassionate and helping as people allow them to help out, is all. I spent my entire life, you know, studying saints and trying and working to understand what they're all about. So, you know, you could trust in what I'm saying. I trust in what I'm saying. I really do. I really feel I have a very good handle on it. And that what you're hearing is a really upgraded clarification of saints that we just haven't had in the world. You know, I've never come across this type of explanation myself. I haven't. This is just something that's I believe the Dharma Kings are giving it to us, you know, and I'm willing to speak it. I really believe it. A lot of what I speak, I believe, comes from the Dharma Kings, or if you want to be a classical Christian, from the Holy Spirit. It comes from the Holy Spirit. But I'm not aware of that happening. I want to clarify, so the clarity just shows up in my mind. I'm able to speak it and feel it and see it and say, this is true. I feel this is true. I try to bring as much clarity as possible. And then I try to make it better tomorrow. But don't deprive yourself of the sublimeness. You know, that's important. Some of the sublime videos, the nature videos, someone is just turned around here in the driveway. You know, I love doing those videos. I'm just in seventh heaven doing them, and I love watching them and looking at it. It's just wow. But I understand that this, you know, is super important. You know, you can't, this is indispensable to really understand how to be free, you know, how to be happy. That's indispensable. So yeah, you have to give a higher priority to this, I would say. But the other side of the coin is important too, because familiarity will bite you. If you're not familiar with the sublime, you will then insist on doubting yourself, and then you'll doubt the explanation that I'm giving you here, right? It works together. Two sides of the coin work together. And I know that I can handle the sublime because I'm doing it. So I feel confident then in clarifying this information for myself, because I know it's going to lead to vision, to seeing mystical vision of seeing everything, you know, casting the light of certainty, reflecting certainty upon me, and I'll see nature in this beautiful, sublime way. I know it's going to happen, so I'm getting ready for that. And the more I get ready for it, the more comfortable I am in seeing, you know, how is this possible? So I can just say, oh yeah, I know why it's happening, and not panic about it. So I have to find sublime stuff. I mean, it's necessary for me right now. I mean, it's really necessary. That's why I say, Dharma Kings, come on, get me into some area that's sublime. I really need it. And so far, they've done it. So I can't complain about it. I mean, they've done just, you know, fabulous job. And I don't put a lot of those videos out for you because I think people have a hard time. It shocks them. They don't know what to do about it. And they, you know, they may say, well, maybe too much. Okay, anyway, I may be getting some pressure here. Someone's going to, no pressure. Okay, it's all good. There's somebody who gets it. They just left. They didn't say, "Hey, I'm leaving." You know, blah, blah, blah. They know I'm taping. They know I'm. I understand. I see. Okay, they're going somewhere. Okay, fine. Don't need to interrupt. Good work. Good work. And that's what the car was for. Someone coming here to pick someone up. Okay, now I get it. All fits together. See, I have an intelligence. I can get it. So there's something there that people are uncomfortable with some of the nature videos because maybe just like, that kind of scares me because I'm not sure about how stable I, you know, it's kind of wow, but I'm shocked. It shocked your expectations. I'm telling you, that foam experience just shocked my expectations like you can't believe. It shocked everybody that was there. Everybody was stunned by it. Everyone was stunned by it. And I was stunned by it. It was so unexpected. We're just like, oh my gosh. And most of them were just like paralyzed. And I was like paralyzed. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to do. And gradually I started working through my paralysis of expectations and my bias. And finally I started flowing with it. And by the end of it, I was like, how I learned to love the foam. I was just flowing with it. Like I was part of it all. And I got used to it, but I had to really work at it. It took every ounce of practice and training that I had to flow with it that way. So I can understand how others would just be like overwhelmed by it and say, I can't relate to this. I can't relate to it. It's too much. It's too much. That's why I put these videos only in the intensive. Those who agreed to take the intensive, only they had access to it because it was so sublime that I felt like it would be too much for others. It was just too much. And this is what I'm seeing is when I post these nature videos for everyone, I feel nobody comments, nobody even likes them. Nobody even says, I like this. It's like, because I don't know why. It must be too much for them. It's not that it wasn't beautiful, because everybody there was saying, this is so amazing. I just can't believe how amazing this is. And it's just, you know, it's like stuff I've never even seen anything like this. It's so amazing. So beautiful. So sublime. Oh, my God. I have the videos, I just don't post them. And the intensive was for those who said, I want to also see the sublime videos. So, you know, I don't know exactly how to do it. For those who want to see those sublime videos, well, I should keep posting them for everybody or not. Maybe, I don't know. That's one thing I've been able to figure out. Because if I put them on unlisted, then you have to get the link to see it. So I was doing that on Facebook, which allows me to set up a group of those, and I put the links for the videos there, so and only they have access to it. So it worked fine. They were able to watch the videos. So I mean, but then you're subjected to all the Facebook junk, you know? That experience, which isn't really that cool at all. So, I mean, is there some way? I mean, I could put up a website and put the links there, and you could visit the website every day, and then you would get the link to the videos on the website. You know, I could do that, but I don't have the money to pay for a website, but I could do through Wix. But I've never gotten any feedback from anyone on all the websites I've put up. I've done this many, many times. Never any feedback from anyone. They don't visit it. You know, I mean, but I could do it that way. or a blog, you know, but nobody visits them. You know, nobody pays any attention. I've had no feedback at all. Like, I like this. This is a good idea. Thank you. Nothing. Nothing. It is so odd. So the Facebook thing actually worked. The people did view the videos and they said, wow, I like this. Thank you. This is really cool. But there's really shockingly beautiful stuff that I haven't made available to the public because the feedback just isn't there. So something's wrong, you know, something that is overwhelming them. But I don't like subjecting people to Facebook. It really is a pain, Facebook. It's very addictive. It sucks up your time. You know, it's a website would work, right? A website would work if you visited it. You got to, guess what? You got to bookmark the website. You got to get used to visiting it. Just like me, I visit surfline.com or Magic Seaweed every day. I got up this morning. I spent like half an hour watching stuff and finding what their content was. I mean, if you really love a website, you're going to learn what the URL is, won't you? Of course you will. Of course you will. So maybe I need to make a new email, like Dharma King Intensive website, Dharma King Intensive, and then you can just type in www.dharmaking, you know, dharmakingintensive.wix.com, and you know, your browser would immediately recognize. I just start taking Magic Seaweed, M-A, boom, goes Magic Seaweed, pops up, and then I click on it. So, I mean, it just takes the tiniest bit of effort on your part to do that, right? The tiniest bit. So I don't see why it's difficult for anyone, and yet it's never happened. I could try again. I could try again and make content available on the website and yeah, I don't know about sharing on Facebook. Facebook's really problematic. I can just cut off all comments. I might do that. But then people keep tagging me and all this stuff pops up. You know, it's just what a pain Facebook is. You can't block it. You can't block it. I might do that. I might put it up on Facebook for people who want to see it. You know, or put it on a website. But I don't know if just posting it on YouTube for everyone, if that's the right thing to do. I don't know. I'll have to get clarity on this. But I'm working. I'm trying to find a way to help those who are willing to be helped without hacking off other people saying this is too beautiful, this bothers me. So you have to opt into the intensive somehow. But I have to cut off comments too. I don't want, you know, for the most part. By the way, everybody in the intensive did a great job. Did a great job. Everyone. They behaved beautifully, you know. They got it. Somehow I didn't even have to tell them. They just didn't comment much at all. They'd watch it, they'd like it or something, but you know, but they didn't try to ask me any questions about stuff. Where is this? So they did a great job. There was like seven of us. They did a great job. And in hindsight, seeing that, you know, I was hoping for more interactivity, but it didn't happen. But that's okay. It's okay. Because they accepted what was made available to them, and they said, wow, this is really neat. I really like this. Some of them did that, yeah. So, but that's all, that's what they should have done. They didn't try to press me or pester me or, you know, ask for some sort of teaching. Give me this, give me that. What do you think about this? None of that. And they never did any of that, which is great. So it was a very successful intensive, actually. I'm just seeing that. So I may do round two, but because I know what needs to, you know, be emphasized, and I have, and we don't want to go into this. There's I know the Tibetans have a teaching about the poisons of the mind and how there's very like five types of mind that's out of whack. And, you know, the overly inquisitive part, you know, ones that ask too many questions, they want to us teaching this, the over-enthusiastic, you know, this, there's all different ways. That's true, it's true. So I don't want any of that, but I want the content to be made available because I'm really getting turned on to you know, tremendous grace, tremendous Dharma King grace. There's no doubt about it. So, you know, there's got to be some way to open that up without falling into some pitfalls. And most people on YouTube in general, you know, they're not ready for it at all. They're not ready at all. So having it unlisted worked out very nicely. I mean, there's just some of the videos are just so intense. It's just, I can't even hardly watch them, actually. It's so intense for me. I just like, wow, it's stunning. It's very stunning. So you have to put that out carefully. Carefully, really. And for those who can't handle it, you know, it's too much. It's not good. I don't want to try to force it on anyone. I really don't. That's compassion says don't do that. But there are some who think that they have to pose as really spiritually advanced, who are really not ready for it, and you know, they shouldn't be looking at it actually, because they feel they have to keep an image that they're but well, I can, you know, explain all that stuff. They're trying to impress other people for their own happiness, you know, in special relationships and stuff, you know, like try to appear like they're really spiritually advanced so someone else will say, oh, you're so wonderful, you know, for me, and their special relationship will be wonderful. And so that, but they end up just, it's like surfing. Like you try to impress the surfer girls and you go out in heavy surf and you just get crushed and, you know, you get almost killed. I used to be an example of that, you know, right? I shouldn't have been surfing. I wasn't fit enough to do that. But I was, you know, I was trying to press the older guys and the surfer girls, probably. You know, like, yeah, I'm some surfer dude. I can ride the good big waves. Like, oh, wow, you're some surfer dude. Wow, you're really cool. You know, I shouldn't have been going out. Almost got killed a bunch of times and just mauled by the waves. And so I was stupid. I shouldn't have done it. So there's some that should not be, you know, seeing these sublime videos, trying to impress others of how so-called spiritual they are. You know, you have to just do it on your own. So I don't care what anyone knows if I'm doing or not. Nobody even knows what I'm doing socially, that I'm socially connected with people. Nobody even knows what I'm doing. And I don't show it to my family or close friends or anything. I don't show anything I'm doing. I don't. They don't even know I'm doing it. Because they're not interested. I'm not going to just say, hey, look, this is a really cool video. You probably like this. I tried it before when I was younger, and it backfired on me, man. So I realized you can't do that. So, you know, I'm trying to work on the answer. If you want to go through the effort of checking the website and clicking on a link to an unlisted video and watching it, you know, and be responsible for your path and not try to impress anybody about what you're doing. It's very important. You're not trying to impress anybody. Don't even let people know that you're on the spiritual path. Like I said, I never told anyone that I was even studying A Course in Miracles. Nobody ever knew. Until I did these videos online, but as far as any of my social sphere, people know and directly know me, nobody ever even knew. Still don't know. After almost, you know, almost 40 years, they still don't know. Because that would bother them severely, you know. They can't handle it. So be humble. Your path goes better if you're humble. If you realize that people, you shouldn't really let them know, it's too much for them, you just do it. If you can handle it, you do it. But don't try to involve other people who don't. It's too much for them. Don't. Of course, it's a lot for Wix. Just doesn't work well on my computer. It a lot of times it doesn't load. It's a real pain. I don't like it. The blog is better, actually. A blog is a lot better. The Google blog, I could do a Google blog actually easily, you know, and that posts beautifully. It works beautifully. There's no hesitation. I can post pictures there, and all you have to do is visit the blog, and then the links would be there, and you could watch the videos. I mean, that would work better than the Wix website. Most people don't visit blogs. But you could, right? So I could do that. That's easy, fast and easy. Dharma King Intensive blog. The Dharma King, you know, Dharma King Intensive. Dharma King Intensives. Dharma King Intensives. Or Dharma King Intensive. Something like that. Dot, you know, Google. I don't know what, how to blog. I'll figure it out. So I could put the URLs for the videos there and explain a little bit about them. And then you'd have to jump through the hoop of going to the blogs every day to find the content and then watching it on YouTube. I recommend watching it on YouTube, opening it up. I recommend watching it in theater mode or full screen mode. And if you can, in 720p. Because this, some of this stuff, yeah, it's just, it's really sublime. And it's unexpected content, content that you don't expect to see or come across at all. You know, it's really out there in terms of, you just like, what is this? I've never seen anything like it. Or, you know, this is very different, anything I expected to see. That's great, helpful stuff. So, I let it marinate, you know, and see, you know, if I can do this. I don't know. I'll keep the options open. But I want to allow others, you know, into the intensive without me giving too much effort on my part. Because I'm not going to email people every time I put up a video up and email 50 different people. That's way too much work on my part. You got to do some work on your part. It's easy for you. Each one of you can just access a blog like that. So I'm not going to saddle myself with too much work. I want to enjoy my life too. And my eyes are going bad. I can't spend all day looking at a computer. It's too much for me. But I have a lot of beautiful content that would be helpful for you. That is for sure. And Facebook, you know, I just didn't like it. Everybody is marketing to you, you know. They're all, and I'm not into that. And I know what I'm doing. I know it's helpful. And it's coming from the Dharma Kings. I know I've put in the work. I deserve, you know, a forum without everybody trying to market me. Say like, yeah, I'm interested in what you're doing. Now look what I'm doing. Look what someone else is doing. And then they bring in all these other teachers. You know, hey, that's great. Let those teachers teach and have their blogs and websites and intensives. Great. I applaud them. But I'm doing my thing here. Okay. So I believe and trust in what I'm doing. And it's different. It's a very different style. And I love it. I love it. I wouldn't be doing it if I don't love it. And I really trust in it. And so I don't want people saying, oh yeah, you know, hey, I like what you did. And here's a link to this guru who's doing something completely different. Maybe you'd like that. I'm not shopping. I'm not in the marketplace for gurus. At this point, I have my Dharma Kings. I trusted them. I love them. I know that they will give us the right information. So I'm not in the market for that stuff. That's why Facebook is really gets dodgy. But I can post there sometimes. I got to eliminate the comments, unfortunately. Because people just don't know how to behave. I don't blame them. I mean, they don't expect anyone to be so certain as I am. They just don't. You don't come across that. You just don't. It's super rare, super rare. I've had to work at it. I could continue to work at it constantly. I know I have a long ways to go, long ways to go. But it's still quite strong compared to what people are used to. It's strong for their expectations. So we'll see what I can do to revamp stuff and get things, get some stuff flowing out to you. All right, very great. That's it for this one.